5, 2015 budget review. One, selectmen's perspective. This was an agenda item for the board to have, offer any comments for the board's own edification and to let their positions be known going forward for the budget. Selectman Woolsey, do you have a selectman's perspective?
I think we all need to see the exact requests that the department head is making and the priorities that he has in mind, and I appreciate the fact that the manager put the budget together without any specific restraints as far as percentages go. I like seeing the basically pretty much the raw request that Fred has been over. This certainly is the largest expenditure in the budget. It's the biggest department in the budget, and is composed of multi-tasks that benefit the town. How comfortable are you, Keith, especially with the road?
Pardon me, just for a second. This is in Public Works specific. This is your perspective on the budget.
Okay, I just want to make sure we can fix the roads.
Okay, we'll get to Public Works. This is
That's
the selectman's perspective.
Okay.
Thank you. Sir.
I tried to pay a lot of attention to this, and I wish I could say that we had taken more out of it, if it was possible.
What more out of?
The budget. If the budget could be a little smaller than what it is.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
I think we still need to look at it. We need to move forward. We have this part right now, but I'm waiting to hear some more information.
Thank you, sir.
I think it was put together nicely, presented to us nicely, mm-hmm. and we still need to look at it and go forward from here.
Thank you, sir. I've got some comments. Second year, into my third year on the budget. And there have been various statements from board members. There have been comments in the press. And I think it's important that we emphasize the voice of financial accounting, the science of actuarial data, statistics, and operations data. And we've requested data for those department heads that are celebritous in their response for operational data. Thank you very much. We hear, and we've heard at this table, that we are growing, that we need more employees, we need three here, we need two there. And I think when you examine statistics, when you examine websites, whether it's the FBI's, the Department of Justice, when you examine the data, I would not disagree with those that would assert that we don't need more employees. Hampton is an aging, law-abiding, safe community. And I'm going to get into some of the data here, and this is going to be a couple of minutes, and it will be statistical. But we're not growing, and that we are revenue challenged, and that we do have some serious encumbrances, and that to protect, specifically want to speak to the union employees in this town and the taxpayers in this town. And I think their interests are interlocked, and I think they're in unison, and I think we protect the people that are paying taxes, and we protect the employees that we have now under what are some significantly arduous financial challenges. In terms of mutual aid, the risk management profession that Mary Louise is part of, they code, they inspect, whether it's commercial or residential properties, just as much as our own town does, to protect their mortgagee interest, to protect banks' interest, to protect their own insurance companies. So that's an ongoing thing. We have mutual aid with the town. We do not exploit our mutual aid options enough with the state. We say we need new police officers. The state of New Hampshire needs to patrol its beach more than they do, and they really don't do much of it. There's no amount of additional personnel, and these are my opinions, of personnel or employees or tax increases that is going to make Hampton safer from an aberrational or sensational or statistically improbable malady or misfortune. It's just not going to happen, in my opinion. And we aren't growing and aging. The New Hampshire Employment Security, off their website yesterday, 2,000. The population in Hampton, 14,973. The population in 2012 is 15,000. So we're growing 4 or 5 people a year. So we are not growing. The Census Bureau is interesting because their numbers are different, but they track the same essential lack of growth. And when you drill down into the metrics of their data and you look at ages, we are just growing older and older, me included, this entire board included, many people in this room. There's less crime, we're more responsible perhaps than young people, and it is an aging community. And in terms of study of crime, crime is down in Hampton, crime is down in the state, and crime is down in the nation. That includes violent crime. And when you do the forensics, that's what shows up. Ed Tinker, in terms of revenue, and he copied board members on this, did a revenue analysis of the new growth. We're growing. And people think because they see new growth, it's money in our bank account. And we're going to talk for a few moments on the fact that it's not. You know, when you factor in abatements, we're actually losing money on the primary sole source of revenue to this town. And in 2012, the tax revenue increase, and this is from an August 11th, 2014, from Ed Tinker, the town of New Hampshire assessor, tax revenue increase was $66,000 from all the building that went on in 2012. Getting on to some of our expenses, the New Hampshire retirement system increase for 2012 was $153,000. So we're bleeding red ink already on just that one line. The 2012 health insurance increase for 2012 was $40,000. Now we're getting into the prudential affairs of, I think, what selectmen really should do is provide information so people can make decisions. So for 2012, from our major funding, and which is our real estate income and all the growth, we lost $127,000. We're in the red on that. That doesn't account any bonding. That doesn't account any other wage increases. Those are just two benefit lines and our major income line. In 2013, importantly, the tax revenue increase from Mr. Tinker's revenue statement from August 11th was a resulting net increase of $15,000, $15,698. In 2013, the New Hampshire retirement system increase was $247,000 from the $153,000 that went up in 2012. So again, we are hemorrhaging revenue on an income statement. There was a health insurance decrease in 2013. Actually, there was a health insurance. There was that play with the refund. So that is it. We're $217,000 in the red in 2013. In 2014, from Mr. Tinker's revenue statements, the town of Hampton increased from its property taxes from the year before $165,000. The New Hampshire retirement system line in 2014 went up $214,000. So we're losing money on that again. 2015 onwards, the finance director has projected a $150,000 increase every year on the health insurance line. So we're challenged by that phenomena. And statistical analysis would indicate that we're not growing and that we're not making a lot of money from this development. I mean, they're just mutually exclusive phenomena. So regarding the New Hampshire retirement system data, that is a study item that's equally as painful as your I&I study. And it's bleak, it's under court challenge, which could increase the amount owed by the town. The contribution rates this year have been assigned for Group 2. For police, it is 26%. For fire, it's 30%. We have a defined benefit plan, but we have no idea. There's no definition of the cost. It has gone free range, and it's out of our control. And this is information that we've requested, specifically, again, talking about the prudential affairs of the town. Legislation enacted in 2011, House Bill 2, made several major changes to the law regarding the retirement system. A coalition representing public employees is currently challenging several legislative enactments in court, including a number of provisions. Two of these are currently in the Supreme Court. So it's gone up 30%. Its increase every year is vastly outpacing our revenue from real estate, and we have no control over it. Additionally, in the union contracts that will be coming up this year, there were requirements for both the town and the unions to establish health insurance committees for a line that is eating us alive. It was never done by the board. It was never done by the unions. And that is not a standard that I think Hampton should continue with. So coming up very quickly, we should have a health insurance committee with some real experts, strategic experts, to unburden us from some of this increase in cost. The outstanding pension obligation is almost $4.7 billion currently. So it's not something that's going to go away overnight. These increases are going to continue, whether there is a court challenge or not. When you delve into the data, and again, this is a selectman's budget perspective, and it's just talking about numbers that are real. In 2003, there were 50,000 active members for the New Hampshire retirement system that were working. The retirees were 17,000. In 2012, there's fewer members. There's 48,000 members actually paying in, and there's almost 30,000 beneficiaries. If you know anything about math, that's not a good formula. That means that rate will probably continue to increase. The unfunded liability that exists right now for that 4.6 is more than two-thirds of the rate that we pay in this town. Two-thirds of our bill for our valuable union employees is for the unfunded portion of this. And I know we have got legislators that have worked on this. It's going to affect GASB going forward. We're coming up and working on those issues. But those are bleak numbers. And so when we hear about studies for or capital improvements for $10 million and you know, we're kicking the can or biting the bullet, there's only so much money out there. And the revenue does not look good. And this budget is this budget. The town has voted to build new fire stations, new police stations. We have great employees. We want to protect them. And I think it's important that we all study the data and that we not just simply say we're growing or this board didn't do that or, you know, we need more employees. And I would say that I would support no new employees, and this is my opinion going forward, based on these numbers, and that we protect those union members and those employees that are out there working very hard for your department, for police, and for fire, and in this building. And when you look at the numbers, you look at the benefits versus the salary. The benefits are uncontrollable by us. They're determined by another body that has accountability to nobody in Concord. We have no control over it. They set the rate and we pay it. And when we start adding employees, those rates continue to go. We can't adequately compensate our employees and protect our taxpayers here. So there's been talk of new employees. I am not in favor, in terms of my perspective, of adding one new employee. And I'm interested in protecting the taxpayer and our present employees here and doing everything we can. And having said that, I think that when we actually look at the numbers, and we actually look at data, we look at crime, and we look at fire, and we look at demographics in this community, it's a fabulous community. I think what we have now is sustainable. And I think that we can continue to march and we identify these challenges, but not to bring these statistics and these demographics into the budget process, I think is irresponsible. Thank you very much for listening to that. I know it was a lot. And now we will get into your budget, sir.
Welcome. I will say there's a connection between the II study and the New Hampshire retirement system. They both involve aging infrastructure.
Amen, sir. Thank you. Your budget, sir.
So, Mr. Chairman, how would you like me to approach this?
Your budget.
Okay. So, you've all been presented with what I've proposed and what the town manager has proposed.
Mm-hmm.
I understand all the town manager's cuts, and we can live we can live those cuts. Do the best we can. I will say that when you talk about manpower, my concern is that
with the responsibilities that we have, particularly in reference to solid waste, really burns up our manpower. There's so many days this summer that we've only had two, if not three, people in the highway department, for the whole highway department, because all of our resources was being spent on solid waste collection. Mm-hmm. So I just want you to appreciate that. You know, like in Exeter, we had 41 employees, but we had no trash to worry about. It was all privatized. Here we have 39 employees, and we have six trash routes in the summertime for 3 months. So I just want you to understand that that's the concern that we have. If we could take trash out of the picture, and then it'd be great, and then we'd have plenty of resources from a manpower standpoint to do the work. That being said, the biggest initiative that I want to put forth for 2015, and I think it's needed, and since I've been here in the last 3 years, I've talked about actually reorganizing the department, making it more streamlined, having a better organizational structure, and with the selectmen's support, we moved forward with that in three phases. Looked at our equipment, and so anyway, that we looked at manpower, and we looked at reorganizing the manpower, utilizing the manpower that we had, not adding on. Since I've been here, we haven't added any additional heads. We just reorganized to make it more efficient, try to get a better utilization of resources. The other thing that we've done is we've gone in and we've looked at all of our equipment, and we've come up with, for the first time, a long-term equipment replacement program that's based on the age and the condition and the use of that equipment. And also, we have been working, and Chris has been taking the lead in this. We've bought GPS units that we've put in both our snow fighting equipment and trucks, as well as our trash trucks, to trace the routes and to try to redesign the routes to make the routes more efficient. Because what we found was that some routes may take an operator an hour and a half to 2 hours to do a complete route, and another operator maybe 4 or 5 hours. And it's a little bit more complicated than just saying, okay, it's just easy to balance out, because there's a number of factors. It certainly takes more time to do certain roads than other roads, and familiarity with the routes and so forth. But we're looking at that. That's something that we're looking at. We've also looked at our buildings and our site, and we've been trying to clean up our site. Some of you, if you've been out there, you've noticed we've been moving things around, making the site more efficient for use of, for all the things that we have to do out there. You've heard me for the last 3 years talking about building a new five-bay garage to house our storm drain crew and have an equipment wash facility, as well as a building to hold our equipment. What I'm proposing, and you will notice at some point that I am not, for the first time for 2015, suggesting that we have any warrant article to fund any new buildings, any new equipment other than replacing some essential pieces of equipment. And even though I initially proposed to have two new employees, particularly for the highway department, I'm not arguing that we can't get by at the moment without those two employees. But what I am looking for is support for the first time to do a public works master plan, where we would have a consultant come in to work with us, not for us, but they would be qualified to come up with cost estimates. It's done in fire departments, police departments, and public works departments, where they come in and they look at utilization of the areas that you want them to look at. We would have three specific areas, and one would be the manpower, equipment, and facilities. So it would be a three-prong approach where they would come in, and we would have our own management team that would work with them, similarly to how we did the Church Street pumps and station project and the dewatering project. We didn't just hire an engineer and just say, hey, go do this, nor did we with this II study. It's all a collaborative effort. We all work as a team to do this, which cuts cost immensely. But have a facilitator come in to work with us, and not just our management team, but also get representation from our workforce and have a sort of like a team committee, whatever you want to call it, but really look at, for 2015, the whole public works operations. One thing that we know and we've looked at is that with all these, and it may not be for a number of years, but we've got to start worrying about tidal effects on that facility. So I can tell you right now, this time's from my office, I can look out and the water's almost on a seriously high tide, almost up to my doorstep. And that's only going to get worse over a period of time. So it may make sense to, and I'm just throwing out crazy ideas, but they may make sense in moving our facility to a different area and reutilizing our offices. It may make sense to look at some other offices in town that would...
Just a point of order, is this consultant in your budget?
Yes.
Proposal?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
So it may, and I'll cut it short. In any case, there's a number of factors that we would look at. I think this is planning for the future, not growth, but handling what we have, our present day responsibilities, but doing it in a more efficient manner. So I have put $30,000 in out of the engineering account to assist us to do that job. Other than that, I'm just going to go through some of the major expenses that we are looking to do. And one is $15,000 for a new vehicle lift in our garage. The lift that's in there now is scary. I wouldn't get under it myself. It's all rusted, corroded, and it's unsafe, and that needs to be replaced as soon as possible. $40,000 for new federal requirements for stormwater management. We had $40,000 in this year's budget for the MS4 requirements. There's a number of things that we are required by law. Once that comes into law, it's been delayed for a number of reasons, but we anticipate, I just went to a meeting last Thursday in Dover on just this very issue, and the EPA expects to be issuing those new federal regulations anytime within the next 2 or 3 months. They'll give us probably 6 months to do it, but we need to spend at least $40,000. That's probably a conservative amount of money to do the requirements that we need to do for those federal requirements. $6,000 for sidewalk sweeper attachment. That's an attachment to go on to one of our sidewalk plows, where we would be able to, in the springtime, after all the sanding and salt, be able to a bit more efficiently sweep the sidewalks. I had put in $100,000 for the repaving of Fairfield, Ruth, and Belmont. The town manager has taken that out with, he's preparing to do a, suggesting to put a warrant article in for that expenditure. Whichever way the board wants to move forward with that, I think it is important. That's a project that we did replace the storm drain in the sewer system 2 years ago, and the roads really do need to be repaved at this point. Also included $12,000 for beach raking at Sun Valley with a private contractor. That's worked out very well this year. It's an expense, but I guess it's something that the town has done utilizing the state contractor over the years, but that's no longer available for us. $6,000 for a cement mixer to help the boys when they're making cement or concrete for different projects. And $40,000 for a stainless steel grit box, which I'm not 100% familiar with, but our wastewater manager is here. You can go in more detail if you want. $8,000 for a sludge blanket level reader, and $140,000 for wastewater treatment plant maintenance items, and $130,000 sewer line maintenance projects. And the good news is we're looking at a decrease of $7,200 in the landfill monitoring cost, because we only have to budget for 1 year, not for two that we had originally anticipated for. So that being said, be happy to go page by page or however you want to do this.
I don't think that's necessary unless the board wants to hear it. I think the board's studied it and it's ready for your questions. Selectman Wilson?
What percent of the department's time is spent collecting the waste? And this is waste and recycling.
If you look at the, I refer them to the highway division.
Right.
I would say
80, 85.
Yeah,
recycling is all waste. Yes, that's what I'm talking
about. I'd say 80 to 85%.
Now, we have been starving our highway crew, and many things that should be done in good weather are not being done. All your weeds and your trimming the bushes and trimming the branches, going over the stop signs, and all the other maintenance work that should be done by Public Works is sidetracked by solid waste. Rolling stock, and you know this is a big deal with me. You have a presentation for us on the rolling stock? I see that we had a piece of information on the town auction, and I have not had a chance to look at that yet. I just got it. But are we going to tone down on the pickup trucks, get some serious Macs or something to do the plowing, get some decent big trucks, and start fine-tuning our rolling stock tool?
We already are. We're in the process of doing that, and you will not find this. We're not looking at any half-ton pickup trucks this in 2015 until we finish this study, which we still need. A lot of the trucks that we have, not a lot, but a number of trucks that we have, were bought just for snow plowing. Mm-hmm. That doesn't make a lot of economic sense.
I agree with you on that. Now, Mike's new computer and the maintenance, is the new computer assisting with better maintenance, more regular maintenance? He's waving his head at me.
Absolutely.
I see you.
Absolutely.
We are keeping better track of the fleet.
Absolutely.
And keeping things, yes. Now we're three mechanics, two and a half mechanics helping. Mm-hmm. Are you ever going to get rid of the Freightliner, please, ever?
Town manager's shaking his head, so I'll shake my head the same way he is.
Oh, Fred.
Now,
Fairfield Drive and paving, which has been a sore spot, I don't want to see any activities fobbed off on the public by means of warrant articles. If it's a routine, normal function that this department should be fulfilling, I want to see money for paving Fairfield and that section of roads in the budget and do it. This putting off is driving me crazy. We have, of course, the town isn't growing. I'm getting that message. So the new builds down at the beach and the new developments and so forth are not creating any waste?
You're asking me?
Well, I mean, the town isn't growing, so we're not performing these functions, so obviously nobody creates waste when they move into the community, even though we have big buildings and we have neighborhoods growing and we have all these projects. I watch the planning board and the zoning board, etc. So the new people moving in to these places that aren't building the town up are not using any waste. They're not using police services. They're not using fire services. They're not creating anything that you have to look out for. You don't have extra roads to plow or anything, do you? Because we're just sitting here stagnating.
Just the point of order here tonight is
I listened to you this
is an agenda item. These are specific budget items. You're mentioning police and fire. I'd like you to ask specific questions regarding the budget that's been presented by the director by line, please.
Okay.
Just keep it specific.
Your track record so far, and Mike Ingris probably on this one, how are the mechanicals holding up? The big new packers, automated packers.
They're taking quite a bit of maintenance because they are so highly mechanical.
Mm-hmm.
So.
We got grease guns on board yet, or do we have the grease? You do, yes. Well. Washdown, you're referring to the MS4 requirements. You've pulled, and you desperately need a washdown facility, and the shed for the sewer. Help me out here. How now do you clean your truck? How do you clean the trucks? How do you wash down the trucks? What area in the Public Works Department is the only area, I assume you have a restricted area, for cleaning the equipment. Otherwise, of course, the trucks can just rot, which some of them are doing. How are you now today cleaning your vehicles?
On the sand pile.
On the sand pile.
On the edge of the sand pile, we're bringing the trash trucks are brought over there, the transfer trailers are brought over there.
Make sure that Chris has the microphone, because the public wants to hear, too.
Thanks. And we have portable power washers, and they're brought over to clean the pieces of equipment.
And the portable power washers work very well in the winter with all the salt?
Yeah, they're steam powered, so they generate their own steam.
But you're limited as to the runoff? You're encapsulating the runoff when you are cleaning these big vehicles?
We're trapping it in the sand.
Trapping it in the sand. Then what happens to the sand?
We bring it up on your road, or the roads. I mean, what it captures is it captures oil.
Yes.
It captures sand.
Yeah.
It captures salt.
Right.
It captures vectors.
Right.
What flies leave us, some swill, things of that nature. It doesn't, we do it there because then the water infiltrates the ground.
Right.
The contaminants, if you will, are captured in the sand. If it's really bad or gritty sand, it can go in the grit box.
I don't want you to think, Mary Louise, that we're, by me saying we're not going to be going for that warrant article in 2015, diminishes the need by no means to have that facility.
I know.
I just think that it's important for us to take a comprehensive look at the department as a whole so that we can make a better
I appreciate
argument
that.
And so forth. So,
but I want the public keys to understand the need, because we have millions of dollars of equipment
right.
in public works. And like any sensible person, I guess most of us go and wash our cars and clean them up. And we're maintaining a large pool of vehicles for town use, and really a primitive way of cleaning them. I imagine you can take your vehicle into the local car wash and some of the pickup trucks into the local car wash.
No, we don't. We bring a lot of the smaller stuff is actually brought inside. And we use the inside bay. For instance, everything from
with the drain.
Right. The one everything from a one ton down gets washed inside.
Okay. But you still are under constraints as to where that wash water can go.
Right.
The aeration tanks, Chris, because that's another feature that belongs with the wastewater treatment operation. And you, I know, were at least planning or starting to look for an area to put them. How critical is it to build the aeration tanks? And do you feel that you have an adequate location?
Not very at this time. And the reason being is if we continue to chase the I&I and reduce and can limit or reduce or eliminate, if you will, the peak flows into the plant, the
mm-hmm.
plant still has plenty of capacity. For instance, this past week it's only operated about 2 to 2.2 million gallons a day. It's designed at 4.17. Right, the 80% limit is 4.7. Well, it's 4.7, but we're limited to just over 4 as 80% of our total capacity.
Right.
So for most days, we do operate, let's say, at 50% capacity.
Right.
The plans, I've seen them, when the original aeration lagoons were put in, there's a placeholder for two more lagoons. If it does, that pathway that you see right to our office
right.
will become
mm-hmm.
very small.
Yeah.
But there is a place to put it. We are not, so it is, it's planned out.
Okay.
But when we look at things like I&I, it's because our vision is really 15, 20 years down the road, and we realize that we chase I&I now, it saves us in the future from having to build my only caution with that is that you asked the question earlier, is the sewer load increasing? Sure, it's going to.
Sure.
I mean, when the last facilities plan was done for the wastewater treatment plant, 2006 and updated in, I think, 2008, they predicted somewhere that the beach would grow at a rate of only 7 units per acre. At the present, given the type of development that's going on and how high it's going, it's currently being developed at about 123 units per acre. Units meaning bedrooms.
But we don't have any growth, and nobody's flushing their toilets, so it shouldn't be a problem.
Well, I think if I may interject at this point, because I think it's important to remember, is that we had a warrant article for a facilities plan study of the wastewater treatment plant. We've got money set aside for that, but we're just waiting for the draft permit, our five-year operating permit, to come back from the EPA. We don't know when that's coming, but mm-hmm. once that comes, then we can really look at what needs to be done, because we don't want to do any work now and then have a new requirement that we need to meet that may make something obsolete, or we may have to add something. So we haven't forgot about that either, but you know, to do that work, but it's just a matter of time till we get that draft permit.
Well, it was Chris's observation. We are not stagnating.
Well, there's a difference. I think Selectman Bean was commenting on the base population of the town.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, that is, well, others have said that it's stagnating.
Mm-hmm.
And but yet the summer beach population, i.e. and then the summer wastewater load and sewer and solid waste load would seasonally adjust or increase.
Mm-hmm.
And it, a lot has to do with the economics. We've seen a tremendous, over the, you know, the last 5 years, and talking about it with staff, if the economy's up, waste and wastewater is up. If the economy's down, I'm sure that the people in business along the beach could tell you. They're mm-hmm. probably a better indicator of what my waste load's going to be than mm-hmm. any other factor.
Now, the Conservation Commission is working with the state and the other coastal communities on that coastal estuary study. And you're referencing the water coming up in Public Works yard because of whatever factors are happening in Mother Nature.
Mm-hmm.
Are you being consulted at all, or have you had any opportunity to make some observations about what's happening to you, because you are basically part of the estuary, you're right located on the water, and if you need to be relocated, where are we going to relocate you to?
That's just one of the factors that we'd be looking for in this study.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
That would be one of the parameters that we'd be looking at.
Okay. Well, I appreciate what you do. There's not enough time or personnel to do it, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
But I support your budget, except for the fact that I do not want to see the money for Fairfield Drive in a special money article, that we know that needs to be done. And I want to see that in the budget.
Selectman Griffin.
All right. In your study, is there anything in this report that you're looking to do that concerns the trash or the solid waste issue?
Not from an operational standpoint.
No, because I wouldn't expect there to be when we just had a big vote.
I'm with you. The last thing I
don't know why you're really learning slow, because you've been here for a long time.
No, I'm learning fast.
It's taken a long time for this to sink in.
No, I'm telling you, that's not in the plan as far as that goes. The plan may look at the amount of trucks that we have right now and how best to house them or how best to utilize their resources, but it hasn't even crossed my mind to be looking. I'm not bringing up solid waste, period.
You know, and I think that you do a good, I think you're wise to do that, because I think the public has spoken. And, you know, and it's also very nice about, you know, Exeter, it's a wonderful town and all, but to hear that they don't even have trash pickup there and their taxes are still 20% higher than they are here in Hampton, to me, is mind-boggling. Mm-hmm. All of my friends that live there have tax bills that are unbelievable.
I do, too.
Yeah. You could probably, I don't know where you live, but I'd say on a $6,000 house in Hampton, you pay about $8,500 in Exeter, and you don't even get trash pickup? That's not where the town of Hampton wants to go. So, you know, I just think that we should take a good look at that. I think it's very important to remember that we just had a very bad economic crunch, and you're very, even a lot of the recycling issues and that, I think, because people weren't buying anything. And you know what it's like when you buy a TV and a this and a that, you have to take a trip to the transfer station.
Mm-hmm.
But today it's going to be different because the stock market's at an all-time high and people are spending money. And it can change again. It doesn't even really depend on the economy for Hampton Beach. After 52 years, I can tell you, when the sun doesn't come out, everyone stays home. And that happened quite a bit. And a lot of people want to think that we had a gangbuster summer this year. That is not the case, from what I understand. I heard that that's not the case at the Seafood Festival. although I'm sure they're still trying to figure it all out. It's not always like it looks. There are people that are coming from out of state, you know, the day trippers and the this and the that. But there's a lot of people that have been business this year that really haven't had a good summer. And I think it really cut good at the end, though. And like Jim says about September, I know that when I plan my surgery, I try to pick which of these, because I had to have it done within these next 4 months, either meaning June, July, August, or September. I didn't want to take September, because September of those months is actually the second busiest month for me. And I think that's pretty indicative of a lot of what happens at the beach. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that it must be beguiling for you to sit in your office and see the high tides come in, but I live on them, and I've lived there for 52 years, and even though there's problems where in the area where I live that come from the state not maintaining their property, the tide doesn't come up any higher to my property, to my back door, where I look and watch and think, oh, it's today the day, than it did 52 years ago. It's the same. So I don't think this is something that we absolutely need to worry about.
No, and Rick, I didn't mean to say we're doing the study because the tide's coming up to my back mm-hmm. door at all. I'm just saying that when we look at it, when we do the study for many other factors, that's going to be a factor we want to consider.
Okay, great. Thank you, and you do a great job. And I wanted to say, too, the other bad part about your wanting to do this study is here we hear all of the bad points about the studies that were done before when it was actually the same ones you're using now. And I thought of it afterwards. I should have asked Teresa, because I knew you knew the answer to that problem, that it was Underwood that did all of the studies.
Yes.
Thank you, Teresa. You do a great job, and I'm glad to see that you have a lot of support from the other guys that are down there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir. Yeah. I, too, looking at the Fairfield Drive, that was something that we did 2 years ago, and we told those people mm-hmm. up there that we need, you know, that we've got the piping in the ground. It needs to settle for a while, which I understand, but it's done that, and now we need to pave that. And so I think the right place for it is in your budget. I think that's part of what we need to do. We need to when we start a project, we need to finish it, and we don't need to keep pushing it down that road. So I agree that it should be in there. As far as your study on your $30,000 for your study, what you need, I agree with that also, because yes, there are certain things that need to be done. A wash station is very important, and I know you know that, and I know that that needs to be done. But let's make sure we're getting all our ducks in a row. Make sure that we're going to get that so that mm-hmm. we're doing it the right way. We all know there's stuff that needs to be done, but we need to make sure that we're doing it the right way. One question I had is I see in here that we have townwide mowing for the $32,000. Now, is that the private contractor that does that? Is that what that
yes.
is?
Yeah, and that's not for just public works. It's for recreation, too.
Recreation,
right.
too. Yeah. We used to do our own mowing years ago. And I know we had some good part-time workers that worked in the summertime that we had. I wonder if we ought to go take a look at that again. I don't know how long the contract is that we have with them or what it is. But the next time that comes up, I would really like to look at that. Mm-hmm. And see if we can do it better ourselves. Can we utilize some part-time people in the summertime to help augment the highway department and the mowing? That might be something we might want to look at.
Mm-hmm.
I believe it's a multi-media contract right now, so we really can't do anything about it. But I would really like to look at that as we move forward to see if that's someplace that we can bring that back in. Utilize some of those employees for doing that mowing and also doing it. So, all right. Yeah.
So, all right, well, thank you.
Selectman Waddell.
Aren't you having fun?
Yeah.
Your budget's going up how much?
I think it's 12.5. Well, my original proposed budget was 12.5%.
It's 11 something.
Actually, I believe mine is 14.5%.
Okay. And
that does include the $100,000 for Fairfield.
Yeah. And you know, when you think about it, the town may not be growing the base, but it's getting older.
Uh-huh.
And all the infrastructure is getting older.
Yep.
And I'm sure you've looked at this and drawn this up, you know, as tight as you can,
mm-hmm.
and utilizing what you're going. You know, I agree with the study. I think that's good. I think you got to have vision. You got to look ahead. You got to plan. Even if you don't do it, you got to mm-hmm. Know what you're going to do in the future. I think it's going to save money in the long run. You know, I'm not going to get into the details of what you do on
right.
a day-to-day basis, but I think the reality is that you need money to fix the town, collect the trash. So I'm in support of this.
Thank you. And I can assure you all that we really do work hard to keep costs down. We don't spend money unless we need to.
I have one quick follow-up when you're done.
I'm not prepared to pass judgment on your budget or any budget that's got significant energy increases. We've got the chairman of the Energy Committee. Dick, you paying attention? Yeah, I'm talking about, we've got the chairman, DeRocious, in the back. He is the chairman of the Energy Commission, and just like to recognize him. There are substantial energy increases across all building platforms and budget platforms, and don't need you to elaborate too extensively, but I would like, before I, this is my opinion, pass judgment, just hear a quick synopsis of yours. Keep it to a minimum to on energy costs and what should be going on with our energy accounts.
There's Dick DeRozier, 40 Salt Meadow.
Good.
Got it? Okay. Thanks.
They want to hear you out there.
What's that?
They want to hear you out there.
Yeah, right. there's two aspects to the energy part of the budget, okay? What we had talked about the other day was the increasing costs that we're seeing right now. I'm still gathering data, and I don't have all the data yet, but what it looks like to me is that the increase in cost is strictly due to the increase in the delivery charge by Unitil.
Yeah.
Example, wastewater treatment plant, okay? They're paying right now about 12.5-13 cents a kilowatt hour for delivery. We base the budget on 6 cents. Transfer stations paying 24 cents a kilowatt hour. We base the budget on 6 cents a kilowatt hour. The budget was based on 2013 costs, which were, it came in at about 4.58 cents a kilowatt hour for delivery. So there's a big substantial increase right there. I don't really see where the usage is more this year than it was last year,
mm-hmm.
but I'm still working on that data. The other part has to do with principally with the wastewater treatment plant. It has to do with the contract that we have with Integrus Energy to supply the power to the wastewater treatment plant. I met last week with our energy broker, Titan Energy, and we're looking at two things. First of all, the fixed price contract that we have on all the G2 or small accounts,
mm-hmm.
there's like 26, 27 of them, that expires next September. And right now we're looking at trying to find a time frame between now and next September where we can get actually a lower rate than what we're paying now. That's a possibility. We're looking at nice things like natural gas, futures, and all that stuff. On the wastewater treatment plant, we've been on a block pricing program since, I think, December. It's been working out pretty well, but it's time to take a look at maybe making some changes to that, and we're taking a look at that. So, yeah, I figure another 3 weeks or so, I should be able to come back in here and give you good analysis.
Good.
That's it on that front.
Thanks, boss.
Any questions?
It's just not as easy as just flipping on the light switch anymore. It's a lot more complicated.
I worry every time I flip the light switch on, though, that it, I worry that it doesn't go on.
Thank you, though.
Yeah, that's.
Thank you, Chairman. Yeah. Appreciate it. In your budget, Director, are any new employees included in this budget that you presented?
Yes, I had two.
Two employees, and what's the salary total for the new employees?
It was 46. 46,297.
297.
What page is that?
Give us a page reference.
Page 94.
94.
Whoops. 92.
92.
And the New Hampshire Retirement System, FICA, FUTA, all those general government expenditures, how are those accounted for?
Those come out of the town office account, and the ballpark is 40%.
40%, I think that's
low. That's not in my budget.
I think that's, I think per my data research earlier, I think that's extremely low, at 40 points. So you've got 46,000 in new people budget plus benefits, mm-hmm, in this budget.
Mm-hmm.
Is the consultant that you mentioned, that is it, is that in the budget?
Yes.
And how much is that?
30,000.
30,000. Okay. And the budget or the consultant that was just in here, how much was that?
That was a warrant article that's not in the operating budget, but it was around 35,000-40,000. I can't remember off the top of my head.
Here's my position is, you've probably got at least a couple of years in the business.
Yeah.
Therese has got a couple of years in the business. Chris has got a couple of years in the business. We've got a brand new town manager. He's probably got a couple of years in the business. You've got some tough guys in back there. You've got a great crew. And I don't think that when we have this many decades and into centuries of experience that the taxpayer needs anything other than your expert opinion. And that's my personal opinion. And if my firm, I've got over 100 years on how to run our retail platform, I think someone's going to come in there and run it better, or Mr. Griffin does, then I don't know how the heck you stay in business. And that's just my personal opinion. Mm-hmm. And you're the director. How many years do you have as a director?
25.
How many in public works?
25.
25. And Mr. Jacobs, how many do you have?
Six.
And civil engineer for how long?
Another 25.
And 50. Mr. Welch, how many do you have?
Public Works, 30.
30. And you know, we're starting to get some real numbers. And then the real boss, Teresa, how many years do you have?
30.
To ask you.
35.
And I'm not interested in hearing paying big tax dollars, 30 grand, to someone to come in and give that many years of experience. And this is my personal opinion. I don't think they had any value. And having read that study, I think a lot of that was in-house capability. It's no new information, and a lot of it can be challenging. That's just my opinion. So I think you know how I feel on that. And back to the board for any wrap-up on this budget.
I have a quick observation. Page 115 on transportation, the tipping fees. So 2014, you're talking 525,000. You're requesting 555. How is the recycling rate holding?
It hovers around 30%.
Still hovering around 30%. Yeah. So we are removing from the waste stream the recycling, at least. We're getting some benefit from having the recycling set up.
Mm-hmm.
But either people aren't recycling the way they should, which is resulting in the increase, but we have more people generating waste, which means you're trucking more waste out of town. Because that's an increase, 5%, something or other increase. So we're creating more waste, the few people of us who are left, the few old guys who are left here.
Well, part of that is a cost of consumer price index increase of, mm-hmm, about a couple of percent, too. So just, mm-hmm, so you understand that. Okay. And fuel increase too, so
okay.
I'm not sure. I haven't announced.
Pound-wise, do you know how, if we've increased substantially?
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head. I mean, that's certainly something that I can find out very quickly.
Before the end of the budget,
sure,
cycle, I'd appreciate that, mm-hmm, information.
The last figures I remember looking at, when you look at the town, Mark Richardson puts them together.
Yes.
If you look at the town, i.e. off-season,
mm-hmm,
we're over 30%. If you look at the town in season,
right,
we're under 30%.
Right. And of course, the state encourages no recycling at all. They say they do, but they don't, so that has an impact too. Okay, thank you, gentlemen. I have no problem with your budget. Make sure that Fairfield stays in there.
Any further comments or questions? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a nice evening.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Gingras and Mr. Doobie, thank you for being here, gentlemen. Good job.